This whole concept of embedding artificial intelligence into our personal and professional lives for more efficiency is a wonderful thing. But when it comes to the human side of things, I get a bit worried, and I think it's so important for all of us to voice our concerns about any technology that may affect the human psyche in negative ways. So today we're going to talk about AI avatars, or digital avatars. When we think about digital assistants or chatbots, we can see how it can be super useful in customer service to answer frequently asked questions. So say for example, we want to book a haircut appointment. It could be really useful in just telling us what the availability is and what the prices are. And that's great. But now let's take that a step further. What if it's programmed to understand what our likes and our dislikes and our social media preferences are? And then it decides to recommend a hair mask because that's what it saw in your search history. Still not too bad. But then what if it's programmed to actually achieve some sort of a goal? So say for example, it only gives you products that are profitable to them, or it gets you to modify your behavior in any way that may benefit them only. What if this is taken out of customer service and applied to different industries? So say for example, like healthcare or education or dating or therapy, do we want our future doctors, teachers, therapists, future spouses, future children, future anything to be digital AI avatars? Hi everyone, welcome back. If you're new here, I'm Alentina, a PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge researching organizational behavior and artificial intelligence. If you're interested in content like this and would like to hear more about the behavioral side and the psychological implications of using artificial intelligence, please be sure to like this video and to subscribe. In today's video, we're going to talk about one, why it's so important to discuss the behavioral and psychological implications of artificial intelligence, especially as it relates to AI avatars. Two, we're going to look at the psychological risks of AI avatars. So we'll talk a little bit about behavior modification, the danger of living in an illusion, and social relationships. And three, we'll end this with some action steps because we're not here just to consume, we're here to learn and to know what the right steps are. And let's not forget that technology can only be as successful as we allow it to be. So why is it so important to talk about the psychological and the behavioral side of artificial intelligence? Well, for one, if we don't, who will, right? So when we see these interactive customer experiences, it sounds all nice and dandy until we realize that it'll actually be a digital avatar. So it's one thing to have CGI in movies, in games, in virtual reality and augmented reality, but it's another when we have to have these one-on-one interactions with CGI, especially one that can not only read our facial expressions, but one that can also generate expressions of its own. Will this be a growing trend? I hope not. I'm definitely not one for fear-mongering, but the reality is that most of these things start out very subtly until it becomes the norm, and then at that point, it's kind of difficult to put an end to it. And so I don't want to engage in fear-mongering. In fact, I absolutely hate that, but I do think it's so important to have these conversations now and to see what's coming, because companies are working now on this in applying AI to CGI. And it's one thing if we keep it in customer service, but it's an entirely different thing if we start applying it to anything that is not customer service. So like we mentioned, healthcare, education, dating, therapy, anything that requires rich human-to-human connections. The thing is that if you speak to techies and engineers, their focus is on the quality of the CGI. So their goal is to make sure that the computer-generated image doesn't look plasticky and doesn't have choppy movements, right? And so they want it to be able to resemble what humans look like, how humans move, and how humans behave. And then if you speak to investors, their focus is on how scalable the product will be and how many different industries we can introduce this type of product. But then we have to ask ourselves, what about the human side of things? Because essentially we're the end user, right? So as someone who studies human behavior and cares deeply about the psychological effects of technology, especially on younger generations, some who are born into it, they're not as aware as us adults. And so the first thought that comes to mind is, how will this affect humans? you know, what will our emotional response to this be? What will the long-term ramifications of these new technologies be? And how will they affect, change, modify our relationships, not just to technology, but our relationships with each other? The scary thing is that over time, we're becoming more dependent on technology, so we're using it more, right, in so many of the things that we do, whether we're working or shopping or connecting with friends and family. But over time, technology is becoming less trustworthy and more invasive. So let's look at some of the psychological risks associated with this. When we think about chatbots, most of the earlier chatbots were rule-based. So those are a bunch of if-then statements. So let's say if the customer uses a certain keyword, then the chatbot knows what it's looking for. So say, for example, in the example with the hairstylist, if you use schedule, then it knows to pull up the calendar and, you know, share the availability. So for an avatar to be interactive in real time, that means it's using some sort of a machine learning technique. And as a quick reminder for anyone who may need it, machine learning is an algorithm that learns through its data and experience. So essentially, it's self-learning. So the more data that it has, the better it learns. And the more data that you provide, it gets better at finding patterns within the data and finding solutions to the problem that you're looking to solve. And with digital avatars, the specific technique is neural nets. Neural nets are machine learning algorithms inspired by the architecture of the human brain. Hence the name neural nets. Think neurons. Okay, so why is this worrisome? Because if we want the AI avatar to actually work and not give us ridiculous answers to questions, then that means it needs a lot of data. Like, a lot, a lot. And where do you think it's getting all this data from? Us. And so that's both a privacy concern as well as a behavioral concern. And so the more the AI knows about us, the better it gets at speaking with us, in engaging in conversation. And when necessary, it can, in ever so slight ways, nudge us towards a behavior. So the AI doesn't have any emotions, it doesn't have any feelings, it doesn't have any morals. All it has is a goal. And so its entire aim is to achieve that goal. And it will do that in any way necessary. So it can do so by showing you images or ads or email reminders, notifications, whatever it's programmed to do for it to achieve that goal. And if the aim of the AI is to change our preferences about something, then it can do that too. Let's not forget the last election. And since then, it's been 4 years. So you best believe the machine learning algorithms and the different AI systems that are out there are a lot better now than they were 4 years ago. And as you can see, it becomes psychological manipulation and behavior modification. And AI can do this in such subtle ways, so subtle that we may not even notice that it's changing our preferences, whether it's something as simple as shopping or something a lot more serious, such as our political vote. So what happens when you embody this intrusive bot in a physical form? I'm not sure if you may have heard of or come across this profile on YouTube or Instagram, but there's a digital influencer called Lil Michaela who has millions of followers. And when I was preparing for this video, I came across one of her videos where she's talking about her breakup. And as always, I like to go through the comments because I like to see how people are reacting to and responding to these type of things. And it was absolutely mind-blowing for me to read some of the comments and see people responding to her saying, you know, stay strong, or that they felt connected to her. And so I had to take a step back to just think about the psychological trip of these people connecting to and looking up to and, you know, taking advice from something that isn't even real to an influencer that has no emotions, that has no feelings, no morals, no history, no real identity. And that just makes me think, what are the psychological effects of connecting to, looking up to, falling in love with, maybe even to something that isn't real, to something that's virtual? And I know some people will be like, okay, who cares? It's just one social media influencer. It's not really that big of a deal. But it really is, because especially if this becomes somewhat of a norm and it's taken out of just, like, let's say, you know, one young social media influencer to doctors online or politicians online, or I don't know, future spouses, future children, whatever it may be, then it's really a problem. Because that's the thing, if we accept this as the norm, then where do you draw the boundaries? Where are the limits where we say it's okay for this to be a digital, you know, avatar, but not for, you know, these areas? And then what happens when the illusion of reality and simulation are mixed? What happens when you start questioning reality, you start questioning what you're seeing or what you're feeling in response to these interactions? What happens when eventually you can't differentiate between an authentic and genuine conversation and one that's with a digital avatar? It reminds me a lot of Plato's allegory of the cave, where the prisoners are seated and they're looking at a wall and all they see are the shadows on the wall, and for them the shadows are reality. And so if we're to think, if this becomes the norm, especially for children who are born into this, then do these digital avatars become the shadows on the wall? You know, do these digital avatars become, in a sense, the reality of the world that they're living in? And so this is so concerning for me, and that's why I felt so compelled to make this video, because I just think so many people need to see this and just stay up to date with what's going on, because it really is going to affect our social relationships. And speaking of social connections, let's look at specifically what that means for social relationships. I think of this in two layers. So the first is the dangers of bonding with the digital avatar. And the second is the dangers of having our own digital clone. So I was recently watching this YouTube Originals documentary with Robert Downey Jr., where he talks about the age of AI. And in this documentary, they're creating a digital clone for Will.i.am. And he says how he wants this digital clone because it'll help him interact with his audience online, respond to comments, whatever it may be. And initially, yes, these things will, because they're so like time consuming and expensive, they'll be reserved for celebrities or politicians or other influential personalities. But who's to say that eventually this may not become the norm, where all of us could have our own digital clones, our own digital avatars? And then what happens then? Is my digital avatar going to, you know, have a conversation with your digital avatar? Where do we draw the line with that? And then if our digital avatars are just, you know, conversing with each other, then where does our connection come from? Now, I know some people are gonna say like, okay, yes, but this is a bit too futuristic. And yes and no, because if we're to, you know, tell our grandparents back then about social media and the presence of social media in our lives, and about how we're basically doing everything, you know, working, shopping, connecting with, dating from behind a thin screen, then I'm sure our grandparents would have had the same reaction. And because of the speed at which technology is advancing, then it's very likely that these things are coming. So, I mean, even if it is just politicians and, you know, celebrities or, you know, doctors and teachers and other influential people, it's still worrisome to think about our relationship with digital avatars. So we have to ask ourselves, do we want to create a future where the norm is, you know, having these emotional attachments to things that can be wiped off, deleted, or, you know, shut down in a split second? Let's all be very mindful of our relationship with technology, and let's look at some steps we can take. The first step is to share this video with friends and family so that more people can be part of this conversation. The second is to be very aware of your social media recommendations. So whether that's Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, whatever, you know, website or app that you're using, be very cognizant of the different recommendations or suggested posts that you're getting. And the reason I say this is because the last thing you want to be or have happened to you is to be pigeonholed into an echo chamber of thought. And I always laugh about this with my sister, because I, you know, some days I'll get a Biden ad and then other days I'll get a Trump ad, and I'm really happy that I've confused my algorithm to the point that it doesn't even know which one I am, because like I said, the last thing I want to be is pigeonholed into some sort of like, or categorized into one group. Because the danger with these things is that better algorithms are actually worse for humanity. So as we saw with the last election, you know, Democrats become more left-leaning and Republicans become more right-leaning. And so the extreme on either side is definitely not something that we want. And 3, when possible, request your data and also hold companies accountable for how they collect your data and what they do with your data. Because companies are a bit savvy with this and they will often, you know, offer a new, you know, feature or whatever it may be in exchange for your data. And the truth is that we don't need to sign away our privacy just to be able to access something new. There will always be a new technology in the market, but we have to take a step back and ask what the behavioral implications of this are. So how does it affect human behavior? How does it affect our relationships? How does it affect collective human behavior? And most importantly, what are the long-term ramifications of this new technology? Let's think about the consequences and think even more deeply about the unintended consequences before blindly accepting any new technology. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, so please let me know how you feel about digital AI avatars in the comments below. Thank you so much for spending a part of your day with me. If you are also even slightly concerned about digital AI avatars, please be sure to share this with your friends and family so that more people are part of this conversation. Let's all do our part in creating a future that promotes human well-being, especially mental well-being. And please be sure to like and subscribe. And if there's anything in particular that you would like to hear about, please let me know in the comments below. Take care and see you next Thursday.